Sister Colleen Ennis, a melodious voice from the Zion Baptist Church, Denver, Colorado.
Dr. Blake, presiding officers, members, and friends. I'm Reverend James Peters, the pastor emeritus of New Hope Baptist Church and former president of the Western States Baptist Convention. And you need to know that we're about to hear from a great spirit. Reverend Frank Davis is the pastor of the Mother Church of the Mountain West region, the Zion Baptist Church. He is the president of the Western States Baptist Convention, an outstanding leader, a great preacher, and I'm happy to present him today. God bless you. Receive him well.
Amen.
Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. To the presiding officer, Dr. Harry Blake, to President Julius Scrugg, let me pause to thank God for your remarkable leadership. Because of your leadership, the National Baptist Convention USA Inc. faced great possibilities. Then let me thank God for the past president, Dr. William J. Shaw. I thank God for allowing me to cross paths with him. Truly, our lives are made richer. We are made better because God has given us a leader that has placed our national work in the right direction. And I pause to thank God for Dr. William J. Shaw. Let me thank God for the President-elect, Dr. Jerry Young. We salute him. And let me say this. God has spoken. And sometimes when God speaks, some of us don't like what we hear. But it doesn't take away from the fact that God has spoken. Thank God for his voice. Thank God for Dr. Young listening to the voice of our God. Then I want to thank God for the General Secretary, Dr. Calvin McKinney. Thank you. The directives that you've given to us to help me even in this day. And all of the officers of the National Baptist Work, we bid you with the love of Christ. I've been taught at an early age to stand up to be seen, speak up to be heard, and sit down to be appreciated. But please allow me a moment to just do a few acknowledgments, and then I'll get to my appointed task. I want to acknowledge all of the delegates from the Western State Baptist Convention, Colorado, Wyoming. Would you please just stand? Wherever you are, I know some of you are here, amen, and I praise God for you. Have our past president, Reverend Bruce Kitchens is out there. God bless you. Certainly we thank God for the president of our Women's Auxiliary, Sister Emma D. Johnson. Thank God for you. Thank God for, amen, our music ministry department, Reverend John W. Richardson and his wife, Sister Dana Richardson. They are outstanding musicians and have led us in a great way in our work. Thank God for, amen, the layman's department, amen. I certainly thank God for the president, Larry Taylor. You all may be seated. And we have on the stage that is sharing with us a General Secretary, Reverend Cleveland Thompson. Thank God for you, amen, and your work. And I want to thank God for Dr. James D. Peters and the kind words that you said in introducing me in this hour. And I want to thank God for the Zion Baptist Church. Everywhere I go, every place I stand, I declare that I am the happiest pastor in all of the world. Not because of where I sit, but because of who sits with me. God has afforded me the blessed privilege of sitting with some of the greatest saints on this side of heaven. And for that, I thank God for Zion. I have my wife with me. She's somewhere. There she is. Sister Kathy, she flew here just to support her husband and her sister, amen, Deaconess Vivian Meanham, and my oldest daughter, Letitia, amen. God bless you all for coming. Solidarity with the Savior as we face the future. Scriptures for that, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 9 through 11, Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 through 8, and if you don't get anything else, I was told that when we come to these conventions and Congress of Christian Education, we ought to go back with the theme right. That is our theme. But under the caption of your theme, I want to talk about finishing well. Finishing well. In the book of Acts, chapter 20, verses 22 through 24, these words are recorded. And now, behold, I go bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the thing that shall befall me there. Say that the Holy Ghost witnesseth in every city, saying, bonds and affliction abide me. But none of these things moves me. None of these things move me. None of these things, I want you to get it, move me. Neither do I count my life dear unto myself, that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry to testify the gospel of the grace of God. This prevailing thought. It's in the text. Underscore that I might finish. Starting things are easy. New beginnings and starting things are easy. Because there are some excitement in new beginning. Anybody around here started something new lately? A new relationship. A new job, a new location. Anybody around here started something new? New president. New deacon. A new church, a new pastorate, starting new. All of the excitement, all of the enthusiasm, all of the high fives, starting new. All of the praise. If you don't hear anything else I say, let me announce to you that the reward is not at the starting point. The reward is at the finish line. As a matter of fact, Jesus said in St. Mark 13:13, Jesus himself said, ye shall be hated by all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth unto the end shall be saved. After all the opposition that men put before you, after all of the pain, after all of the problems, after all of the persecution, if you're going to get rewarded, you have to persevere. And you know, I've noticed in my little walk with Christ, I've seen folks, Christian, many of them with good intention, started the race just to fall out. I watched them start with excitement. I watched them start with gusto. I watched them start. But soon they were hit with criticism. Soon people start treating them mean and cruel. Oh, let me say this. I don't want to be long. Let me say this. Don't you think that this Christian journey is an easy journey? When you reach a state of grace, you must still hope and pray for most grace. When you enter into the straight gate, help me, Holy Ghost, you must still walk the narrow way. And I got to declare, it's not easy. I've seen folks fall out. And I know what you're thinking. Say, well, Reverend, is it possible that we can make journey in? Well, I've seen some folks. I've seen some Christians finish well. I observed the late Dr. Wendell Theodore Liggins, 51 years at Zion Baptist Church. I watched him finish well. And he, you know what he would do? He would get up in his messages. And at the conclusion of his message, he would say, walk together, children. Don't you get weary. Walk together, children. Don't you get tired. There's a great camp meeting in the promised land. All he was trying to say is finish and finish well. Oh yeah, I've seen some folks that have finished well. The late Deacon John D. Jackson served 49 years at Zion Baptist Church, and I watched him stricken with cancer. I watched him how he would come to the church every time the church door was open, Sunday morning, Sunday night, midweek praise and prayer service, Bible study. I watched him make a difference. Even with sickness all over his body, I watched him cut, trimming hedges, cutting lawns. And every Wednesday night, I saw him at church and doing the testimony period. He would get up and say in his baritone voice, sing a song. And the song was, I'm going to do all I can for my Lord. I'm going to do all I can for my Lord. I'm going to do all I can till I can't do no more. I'm going to do all I can for the Lord. So it is possible to finish and to finish well. In the text, the Apostle Paul, if anybody can tell you how to finish well, it ought to be Paul. You do know what he said to his son in ministry, Timothy, in the second book of Timothy, chapter 4, verse 7 and 8, he said, I fought a good fight. I finished my course. I kept the faith. henceforth that leadeth for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous God, shall give unto me on that day. But not only for me, but for all of those that love his appearing. I feel all right now. Yes, Paul in the text gives us some directives on how to finish and how to finish well. And the first thing I noticed in the text was, if you're going to finish and finish well, you must have a cheerful anticipation of personal suffering. A cheerful anticipation of personal suffering. I'm not making it up. Look what Paul says in that 23rd verse. Look what he says. He says, say that the Holy Ghost witnesses in every city, saying, bounds and affliction abides me. He said, Paul said, I don't know what else is going on. I don't know what else is waiting out there for me, but I do know this. I do know I will go through some personal suffering. What's wrong with us? Every time we go through any suffering, we want to quit on the Lord. Every time somebody says something about our name, scandalize our name, we want to quit on the Lord. But my brothers and sisters, if you're going to stand and finish your course, you must go through some personal suffering. No, I like Jesus. Jesus did not try to deceive us. Look at what he says, St. John 16 and 33. He said, these things have I spoken unto you, that you might have peace in this life, in this world. No matter what translation you're reading, in this world ye shall have tribulation. But, help me out, be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. In other words, Jesus said, you're going to have some suffering. And you know what? We ought to always look at what other folks are doing. We can sell folks to go on and stay with it and stick to it. You know, we can give them all kind of advice. We can even analyze their lives. But when suffering hits us, when it hits us, sometimes we think like God is picking on us. But his word says you're going to have some personal suffering. As a matter of fact, Paul recalls over there in the second book of Corinthians, chapter 4, verse 7, verse 8 and 9. He said, we are troubled on every side, yet not distressed, perplexed but not in despair, persecuted but not forsaken, cast down but not destroyed. All Paul is saying is some personal suffering will come your way. And you got to be able to get through personal suffering. And I know what you're thinking. Reverend, how can I get through personal suffering when the folks that I trusted stabbed me in the back? How can I get through personal suffering when folks outside of the church doesn't even bother me? It's those that I worship with every day, and they are digging ditches in my way. Reverend, I trusted them, and how can I deal with personal suffering. Let me say this. You can trust everybody. There is not one person that you cannot trust. But you got to understand what you can trust them to do. You can trust some folks to lie. You can trust some folk to stab you in the back. You can trust some folk to dig ditches in your way. And you can have a joyful anticipation, because you know what? When you trust somebody to lie and they lie on you, you start laughing from the inside. Say, I knew he was going to do it. It doesn't catch you by surprise. You can trust. And then again, you got to have a cheerful anticipation. How can I have a cheerful? Paul, help me. Help me, Paul. How can I have a cheerful pain? How can I have a cheerful anticipation? Well, look what he says. I'm just about finished. Look what he says in Philippians. Chapter 4, verse 4-7. Look what he said. He said, rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. And he said, here's the key. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything through prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will keep you, your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. I'm trying to help somebody get to the finish line. And you know what? You have to pray. I think it was A.J. Gordon that said this. He said, you can do more than pray after you have prayed. But you can never do more than pray until you have prayed. Help me out, Holy Ghost. In other words, he signed to say, if you're going to endure personal suffering, and you're going to do it with a cheerful anticipation, you got to learn how to pray. Every day I pray. I pray and ask the Lord, Jesus, don't leave me by myself. Then I saw another thing. I saw another directive in the text. I saw a commitment to being humble. Look what he says. Paul, you do know the story. Paul is completing an assignment in Asia Minor. Oh, yeah. He's completing an assignment, but his work is not finished. I got to say this. On my way back to Colorado, I got to say this. We have completed an assignment of campaigning. But the work, help me, Holy Ghost, is not finished. Yeah. The campaigning part is, but the work is not finished. Look, if you're going to finish the work, you have to have a commitment to being humble. In other words, you got to get self out of the way. What's wrong with us? We got too much self, and we can't see the servant. We got too much self, and we can't praise the Savior. Too much self. Got to learn how to get self out of the way. Me, myself, and I know you know this, and I don't want to insult your intelligence, but it's not about you. My church, my ministry, it's not about my power. It's not about you. You don't own anything. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, and the world is they that dwell therein. I want to just tell you, you got to get out of yourself. Now let me give you a working definition of humble. I think C.S. Lewis had it best when he said, being humble is not thinking less of yourself, but it is thinking less of yourself. Thinking of yourself less. In other words, get the thinking more than about you. Get the thinking about how you can feed the hungry. Get the thinking about how you can clothe the naked. Get the thinking about how you can help somebody along the way. You got to be humble. And when you're humble, that's when you receive favor. James says in James 4 and 6, James says, he give grace to the humble. Jesus said in St. Luke 14 and 11, he that humbles himself shall be exalted. You ought to be committed to being humble. It doesn't matter if they call your name. Known as the name of Jesus is being pronounced. It really doesn't matter who does the work. As long as the work gets done, get in a position where God can use you. Got to be humble. And then I saw a commission with a gift. A commission with a gift. Look what he says. He says, that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry that I have received of the Lord Jesus Christ. In other words, the ministry. God has commissioned us. He has given us a work. And that work is to serve. If you're saved, then you're saved to serve. And it's not serving yourself. You're saved to serve others. And so then, my brothers and sisters, I just want to tell you that you have a work to do. And when God gives you a work, you ought to be about the work of the Lord. He said, go ye into the hedges and highways of life. He said, go into all of the world and teach and preach and proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. And I know what you're saying. Well, Reverend, I don't really talk about the Lord. I just live. I don't get in conversation about Jesus. I just live. But if you got something on the inside, it ought to manifest itself on the outside. And let me tell you, God didn't put you in a mean world without giving you the ability to do what he wants you to do. Whatever God has given you, you ought to stand in your position and do it. Look now, some of us, God has given us mighty gifts, and some of us, God has given gifts. But whatever gift God has given you, you ought to use it for the glory of his kingdom. If he given you a gift of singing, you ought to sing for his glory. If he's given you the gift of teaching, you ought to teach unto his glory. And I don't know about you, I'm not much. And I don't try to preach like nobody else, because I'm Frank Marvin Davis, and God has purposed Frank Marvin Davis to to preach his gospel. He didn't need me to try to be like C.W.A. Clark. He didn't need me to try to be like Dr. Sampson. He didn't need me to preach like Dr. William J. Shaw. But he told me, Frank Marvin Davis, be all of the Frank Marvin Davis that I have purposed you to be. Preach the way that I have instructed you to be. And I'm just trying to tell you, as I run to my seat, you can make it to the end. You can make it to the finish line. All you got to do is have a cheerful expectation or anticipation of personal suffering. You can make it. All you have to do, my brothers and sisters, you can make it. All you have to do is have a commitment to being humble. All you have to do is have, understanding that you are commissioned with the gift. And as I take my seat, Paul, somebody is wondering here, how could Paul say, I'm going to a place, and I know when I get there, there is nothing but trouble. I'm going to a place, and when I get there, there's nothing but tribulation. I'm going to a place, when I get there, there's nothing but tears. How could Paul say that? And the final thing I'm trying to tell you, you must understand that you are conscripts and not volunteers. You got to understand that you've been drafted into God's army. See, Paul said, I got to go. I'm bound in the spirit. Paul was saying, I don't have any choice in the matter. There's an inner necessity about me that tells me I've been drafted in his army. How many of you have been drafted in the army of God? I've been in the military, and I was drafted in the military. And when I was drafted, I didn't like the food. When I was drafted, I didn't like my living quarters. When I was drafted, I didn't like the assignments. I didn't even like the career that I was in, but I had to stay with it because I had orders by the master. And let me tell you, that's what it is about this Christian journey. Something you might not like, but you've been drafted. Stay on in there because you've been drafted by the Lord. I'm through, but I'm happy. I'm happy. Let me close and let me sit down now. I got to tell a story. I'm a country boy, and I'm from Bryan College Station. And I was raised in a rural area. And in that rural area, there was a little school. The little school was a John M. Moore Elementary School. And every May, we had what we called May Day. And May Day was a time that we would run around and play. It was a time of competition. And the grand finale was the mile race. Let me tell you the true confession. The grand occasion was the mile race. And you know what? The principal got us all together. And he said, everyone that participates in the mile race, everyone will be rewarded with a ribbon. And you know what? I'm a little athletic. I'm not bragging on myself, but I said, I'm going to beat everybody in this mile race. And y'all know what a mile race is. It's four times around a football field. And you know, we lined up loved, and we took out, and I gave it all that I had. I got to tell you, and the sun, it's May Day in Texas, and the sun was hot. I started sweating, but I kept on pushing. Yeah, the sun was hot, and looked like I was catching a crab, Dr. Shaw, but I kept on pushing, and I kept on running, and I crossed the finish line in first place. But there was a classmate of mine. His name was John Travis Johnson, and he was a little heavy. I watched him. I even lapped him, but I watched him, and he started off running. Oh, yeah, but the second lap, Dr. Blake, he was walking. I watched him, and then looked like in the third lap, Dr. Scruggs looked like he pulled a muscle because he started limping in the third lap. But he came to the finish line, and we all went to the assembly. And at the assembly, yeah, I came, and they put a ribbon over me, Dr. McKinney. It was a red ribbon, and I watched everybody else get the same ribbon. Yeah, they put the same ribbon on everybody's head. Good God Almighty. And I got, oh yeah, you know what I got. I said, well, I can't understand this thing. I was a little despondent because I finished in first place, and I wonder why everybody got the same ribbon. Oh, yeah, look at it. I'm taking my seat now, but look at it. Principal Otherbird said, what's wrong with you, Frank? I said, I don't understand. Sister Gatewood, I told him, I don't understand why I finished in first place, and you didn't even put me on a pedestal. I finished in first place, and you put every ribbon on everybody. He said, Frank, you didn't get the instruction. I said, everybody that finished the race would get the same ribbon. And I got to tell somebody here, it doesn't matter how you get there, as long as you finish the finish line, you might have to limp in, but that's all right. You got to stay there. You got to stay there. I'm through, but I'm happy. There's something at the finish line. There's something at the finish line. At the finish line, you can lay down your heavy burdens. At the finish line, you won't have to suffer no more. At the finish line, no more lying on you. At the finish line, there will be no more hypocrites. At the finish line, oh Lord, you can dance and shout. I'm through, but somebody needs to get to the finish line. I'm going on. Yeah, the assignment of campaigning is all over. But the work, oh yeah, the work is not finished. Stay here, National Baptist Convention. You got to get to the finish line. And if you get to the finish line, God will give you a reward. Oh, when I come to the end of my journey, weary of life and the battle is won, carrying the staff and the cross of redemption, he'll understand and say, well done.
Father, I stretch my hand to thee, no other help I know. I wish that every one of us will stand together as we close together with prayer. I want you as much as possible in twos, join hands together in twos. In groups of twos, maybe three, not more than three, hand in hand. And since God has no hearing problem, he can hear all of us at the same time. Don't want you to sing now. I want you to pray now. I want you to pray. Talk to your partner. If they have a prayer need, talk about it and begin to pray. 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 Begin to pray.